be greeted in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Going through Gethsemane. That is the theme for today. Going through Gethsemane. We will find our scripture reading from Matthew 26:36-39, as well as 42 and 44. You may read.
Then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane and said to the disciples, "Sit here while I go and pray over there." And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and he began to be sorrowful and deeply distressed. Then he said to them, "My soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Stay here and watch with me." He went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, saying, "Oh, my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will."
42.
Again, a second time, he went away and prayed, saying, "Oh, my Father, if this cup cannot pass away from me, unless I drink it, your will be done."
44.
So he left them, went away again, and prayed the third time, saying the same words.
We thank God for the reading of his word. As we continue with this journey called life, there are times where we find ourselves happy, well, and content. But along the way, things can change. And we then find ourselves going through hard times, going through Gethsemane. Jesus Christ, the Savior of the whole world, who is God, or the firstborn of God, also went through
Gethsemane.
It is therefore not surprising if we too, at one point or another, we find ourselves walking the same path. No servant is greater than his master. That says the word. John 13:16. No servant is greater than his master. If we are followers of Jesus Christ, it means that we will walk the same path he walked. If he went through
Gethsemane,
it also means that we will go through
Gethsemane.
We will walk through Gethsemane. But we will not stay there. We will just walk through and pass. Jesus Christ was in Gethsemane for a short period of time. According to scriptures, if we read well, we will find out that he was there for a very short period of time. Meaning that if we ever find ourselves going through Gethsemane, we must take courage. We will pass. We will be on the other side. Soon or later. No one stays in Gethsemane permanently. It is not possible. But there are people who lose hope when they are going through
Gethsemane.
For some, it is a time of putting one foot in both kingdoms. This is a challenge believers are facing. When believers go through Gethsemane, some of them, it is a time of putting one foot in both kingdoms. While for some, they completely abandon their true faith and go back to the world on a full-time basis. Some will just put one foot in both kingdoms. Some will find themselves going back to the world, abandoning the true faith, going back on a full-time basis. But we thank God because there are some who remain in their true faith. There are some who remain, those who are rooted and grounded in the word. They remain standing in the true faith. The evil one has a hand in this. He is the one who is tossing people to and fro. He has a hand in this. He goes around whispering to people, telling them or showing them that their situation has deteriorated from better to worse because of coming to Christ. And unfortunately, some believe. In that statement, he omits the fact that he is the one responsible for putting the individual in that position in the first place. The mind of a person is a place where the evil one goes in and out as he pleases, undetected. We should guard our minds. We should guard our thoughts, because the mind is the only place that he can go in and out unnoticed and as he pleases. If he can succeed and conquer the believer's mind, he will begin to direct the course of his life. From there, nothing will be good. Believers, let us guard our minds even as we are going through Gethsemane. Because the devil, the evil one, can go in and out, and we may not even notice that he is in at a certain point of time. We will think it is our own minds, whereas it is not. It is him. But children of God, take courage. Gethsemane is a garden. It is a garden. No garden can take up the whole land. A garden can take only a small portion of a land. And the remaining part will be free. Gardens have got where they begin, and they have got where they end. Suppose where we are, it is a garden. If we are walking this journey of life and we enter through that one end and keep walking, sooner or later, we will be out of the garden on the other end. Provided we keep walking. Now the challenge is, when we enter this garden called Gethsemane, some stand and forget to walk. They forget to keep walking. A walk which is called prayer. As soon as the hard times fall upon them, that is when they are in that garden. They stop. Everything stop. Everything about prayer stop. For some, it reduces. They reduce the time spent on prayer and the word. This is nearly the same as stopping. Because in that way, we allow or we open doors for the devil to bring in more thoughts which are not building at all. We should keep walking a spiritual walk called prayer. When we are in that garden, it is not a time of complaining. It is not a time of thinking about our challenges. It is a time of prayer. We should not complain. We should not compare ourselves with our neighbors or any other person. Suppose this stage where we are, where I'm standing, is a life of a person. Now, the day the person was born is the day he stepped on top of the stage at that other end. Now, the believer or a person, not a believer, because when a person is born, he is not yet a Christian, but he keeps walking the walk that he chooses to walk. Now, as he goes on with this walk, or as he goes on in this journey, from that end of the stage, going to his destination, which is that other end of the stage, along the way, he come across the gospel of Jesus. He accept Jesus. Suppose from there to here, he had no challenges. All was well. But the moment he reaches here, he accept Jesus Christ. Now, the believer has attracted a certain kingdom to look upon him or to look at him, not for good, for evil. Now the believer, he is now a believer in Christ. He is praying, he is reading the word, but he has attracted another kingdom. As I'm walking, you are able to see me with your natural eye. If you can see me, it means that the evil kingdom can as well see me, and not for good. Now I am walking, I am praying, I am happy, I have accepted Jesus. Now the evil kingdom plant a garden because it has seen that I'm going towards my destination and I'm even almost there comparing where I left. I am almost there. Now where the drums are, the evil one put Gethsemane. Now the Christian continued to walk, minding his own business. Now he finds himself facing hard times. This is Gethsemane. He is in Gethsemane. He has read the word. He knows very well that he must keep on praying while he is in this garden. But for some reason, the believer forgets. He starts to compare himself with others. He starts to complain. He looks on his left. He saw his neighbor, Temba. When he checks, everything seems to be well. He is playing his instruments, coming to church, all is well. He looks at himself, nothing is well. Check on the other side. He sees Andile, the guitarist, playing his guitar. All is well with him. Look at himself. Nothing seems good. In front, there is another neighbor, Evangelist Rapad. All is well. All this time, the believer is not praying. He is comparing himself with the others. Now he has finished. There is no other neighbor. Behind, there is nothing. He stays at the far end of the road. There is nothing. He is just in the garden. And there is nothing behind. Now he turns his attention to the garden. This tree, these olives, they are very bitter. Remember, in the garden of Gethsemane, there are olive trees. And olive trees have got olives, which are bitter. Now he start to look at them. This tree, it's long as it has been here. Now where is God? Why is he not uprooting this tree? Last year, it was down here. Now it has grown to this height. And now it is even bearing olives. And these olives are very bitter. The believer has forgotten to pray. He is comparing himself with the others, as well as looking around the garden. During this time, what he was supposed to do in order for him to pass and reach his destination, he was supposed to do what Jesus did. Verse 39, read 39, 42, and 44 of the same scripture.
Again, a second time, he went away and prayed, saying, "Oh, my Father, if this cup can pass away from me, unless I drink it, your will be done."
44.
So he left them. He went away again and prayed the third time, saying the same words.
Now, while Jesus was in
Gethsemane,
he prayed three times within a very short period of time, which means that as believers, when we face challenges, we should increase our prayer times. In one day, we can pray as many as we can. Prayer does not mean to talk aloud. We can pray in our hearts, even as we are going along with our work, in our workplace, or wherever we are. This will help that we will not fall into temptation. We should copy the example of Jesus. We should do as Jesus did. In fact, my Bible tells me in 1 Thessalonians 5:17 that we should keep on praying. Pray continually. The Bible never said when you reach Gethsemane, stop for a while, you will continue when you cross over. The Bible said pray continually. That is, we pray in happy times as well as when we are going through Gethsemane. Who of you, by worrying? That is
Matthew 6:37.
Can move out of Gethsemane faster. Who of you by worrying can add a single hour to his life? It is not possible. By worrying and stop praying, we cannot add even a single hour. But by prayer, we can move out of Gethsemane. We can get the desires of our hearts. The challenge is that the length of time a person can spend in Gethsemane is not the same as for other people. This is the reason believers compare themselves and say, so and so went through this, but within a year, he was out. Now I have been in this situation. It is now 5 years. I am still here. The length of time we spend in Gethsemane differs from individual to individual. We should never compare ourselves with others. What we need to do is to keep praying. There is also another danger while we are in Gethsemane. The danger of cursing the very people who are persecuting us. What we need to do is to bless our persecutors. Remember, the evil one cannot come by himself and persecute you. He will use your sister or your brother in the Lord. He can even use your own children or any other person for that matter to carry out his agenda. When going through Gethsemane, we should imitate what Christ did. He blessed those who were persecuting him. He did not curse them. He blessed them. If we are not careful, we will find ourselves committing sin, paying revenge, and cursing our persecutors. Can you go to verse 50 and 51 of the same scripture?
But Jesus said to him, "Friend, why have you come?" Then they came and laid hands on Jesus and took him. And suddenly, one of those who were with Jesus stretched out his hand and drew his sword, struck the servant of the high priest, and cut off his ear.
Now, do you see what the companion of Jesus did? The companion of Jesus did? When he saw that Jesus was about to be arrested, or he has been arrested already, he drew out his sword in order to revenge or to fight and protect the Savior. The Savior does not need protection. But Jesus, when he was persecuted, he blessed his persecutor. In Luke 22:51, we find that Jesus touched the man's ear and healed him. His companion cut the ear of the servant of the high priest, although he was not the one who was going to the cross, but he fought for Jesus. Now note what Jesus did. The very same person who was being arrested, he touched the ear of the very same people who were coming to arrest him, the servant of the high priest, and he healed him. He blessed him. Jesus left us an example to follow in doing this. In other words, he is showing us that we will be persecuted by our fellow brothers and sisters. We will go through Gethsemane because of our brothers and sisters. But it is not them. It is the evil one using them. We should therefore bless them. We should pray for them. Whatever they did to us, we should pray and ask God to help them. As for those who are not yet in Christ, we should make a prayer of asking God to open up their eyes so that they too may come to Christ. For those who are already in Christ, we should just pray and bless them. We bless our persecutors just like Jesus did. In doing that, he was leaving an example for us to follow as his children. He knew very well that he was going to the cross, but that did not stop him to bless the very same people who were coming to arrest him. He cannot go against his word. Jesus is the word. He cannot go against his word and curse the people. But he expects us to follow his example, because he has given us the word of God to read and follow. Romans 6:13 says, "Do not offer any part of your body to sin as instrument of wickedness, but rather offer them to God as those who have been brought from death to life. Offer the parts of your body to him as instruments of righteousness." The one who cut the servant of the high priest,
yeah.
His name was Malchus, the one whose ear was cut. That person who cut the ear, he allowed his hand to be used as instrument of wickedness. He allowed the part of his body called the hand to cut somebody's ear. That is wickedness. But Jesus used the very same hand, I mean the part of the body, to bless, to touch. We as children of God, we should not allow our body to be used as instrument of wickedness. When we are going through Gethsemane, we should allow all the parts of our body to be used to bless those who are persecuting us. We can use our mouth to pray for them and bless them. We can use our hands or any part of our body to bless. That way, we will be obeying the commandments. We will be walking according to the word of God. Romans 12:14 says, bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. When we go down to 17, it says, do not repay anyone evil for evil. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. When we go down to verse 19, it says, do not take revenge. What Jesus' companion did, he was repaying evil for evil, whereas the word does not allow us to do so. When we are going through Gethsemane, there is also something that we learned in the passage we read. In all the three prayers that Jesus did, he kept on saying, let your will be done. Let your will be done. Meaning that even as we are going through Gethsemane, the will of God must still be done. The will of God should prevail. Christ prayed. And that is what we ought to do as believers when we go through Gethsemane. But in our prayers, we should also allow or imitate Christ's prayer. Let your will be done. He said it three times as he was praying. Though he wanted relief, but he still said, let your will be done. Even when we want relief, when we are going through Gethsemane, we should not forget that the will of God should prevail in all situations. Even the prayer which Jesus taught his disciples in Matthew 6, it has this statement, let your will be done. Let your will be done. Even when we pray, asking God for relief, we should still say, your will, Father, must be done in my life as it is done in heaven. We will pass that Gethsemane. Nobody stays in Gethsemane permanently. One thing we noted in this passage, the very same passage we read, even though we did not read the whole passage, is that Jesus was betrayed by one of his own. This is a sad part of Gethsemane. Gethsemane is sad It is a sad case when we know that the people who are bringing it, or the people who are allowing the devil to use them to bring it to us, are our sisters and brothers. Judas Iscariot was one of the 12. Yet he allowed Satan to use him. He knew the ministry of Jesus very well. He even knew that Jesus often goes to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. That is the reason that day, the day he betrayed him, it was not even difficult because he knew where to find him. He knew that Jesus is a man of prayer, and he does sometimes go to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. But that day, the garden was used as a place where he will be arrested. Now, I said the sad part of Gethsemane is that the people that we are close to can be used by the evil one to torment us. They can be used to persecute us. Even as it happens that way, we should still pray for them as we are praying for ourselves. We should still bless them. We should never curse them. The people who were against Jesus, or the people who were against Jesus' ministry, were not sinners. They were the high priests. They were the elders. The people who knew the law very well. The people who knew God. The high priests. The elders of the church. They were against Jesus' ministry. What they failed to notice was that the ministry of Jesus and their own ministry is one and the same thing. They are both serving the same God. But they were so bitter. They were angry against him to a point that they opened a door and allowed the evil one to use them to take the Christ to the cross. It is true. He was supposed to go for the sake of us. But the way it came, this is painful, because it came through the high priest, the elders, the people who know his God very well. True, he was supposed to go to the cross. That is why he came here. But it was not supposed to have come through the high priest and the elders. This is what is happening today. Churches are against one another. Instead of fighting the evil one, we fight one another. The pastors, they cannot sit next to each other. But we are serving the same God. Even Christians from one church and another church, they cannot stand in one place and discuss the Bible. Yet this is surprising. We are serving the same God. It happened during the time of Jesus, and it is still happening now. Children of God, let us fight this devil. Let us stop fighting one another. The evil one is not our neighboring church. The evil one is not my pastor or my fellow Christian. The evil one is the devil working through people. So let's fight him. Let's not fight our fellow brothers and sisters. Because of that, the priests and the elders, they were able to be used by darkness when it was not supposed to be so. His own people, the people of Israel, on the day of crucifixion, they stood there supporting the elders and the high priest. When Pilate, Pontius Pilate, wanted to release Jesus because he saw no basis for crucifying him, he wanted to release him. Pontius Pilate was not a believer, but he wanted justice to be exercised. He saw no basis for condemning Jesus, but his own people stood and shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" This is said. If your own brother and sister can stand and say, "Crucify him," that is said. But pray for him. Pray for him. Bless him. Do not curse him. You will soon pass that Gethsemane. Gethsemane is just a garden. I said so. It is very small. If we do not stand and start to think, comparing ourselves with others, our neighbors, and even the trees in the garden, but if we keep walking, we will be out very soon. Even if it takes long, take courage. We will all come out. I said, the time spent differs from individual to individual. If I spend 5 months in Gethsemane, my interpreter here can spend 3 years, but she must not complain. She must keep on praying and keep walking. Do not stand still. While you are walking, praying for yourself, pray for their persecutors. Bless them. Do not curse them. If possible, preach the gospel to them as well, because they do not know what they are doing. They know not what they are doing. The God of this world has blinded their eyes. He has succeeded in blinding the eyes of unbelievers and even crept in the church and blind some believers to a point where they allow themselves to be used by the evil one to persecute their fellow brothers and sisters. Bless them. Pray for them that their eyes should be opened as well as your eyes are opened. Children of God, financial stability does not prevent a person to go through Gethsemane. Some people are mistaken. They think that once I get all that my heart desires, if I get a job that I want and earn this kind of salary, I will not go through Gethsemane. It is not true. A person can still go through Gethsemane. There are many ways the devil can bring Gethsemane to a person. Remember what happened to King David. When his throne was firmly established and God has given him rest on all sides. For it is written in the word, God gave David victory wherever he went. Which means that as a king, financially he was stable. As written in the word, the God of heaven was giving him victory wherever he went. It is written in the word. Also, he had a family. He had wives and children, which means that everything was well. But not so. One day, Satan used one of his sons to put him through Gethsemane. His name is Absalom. You will remember very well what Absalom did. Can we quickly go there? 2 Samuel 15, 1 to 6.
Samuel 15, 1 to 6. After this, it happened that Absalom provided himself with chariots and horses, and 50 men to run before him. Now Absalom would rise early and stand beside the way to the gate. So it was, whenever anyone who had a lawsuit came to the king for a decision, that Absalom would call to him and say, "What city are you from?" And he would say, "Your servant is from such and such a tribe of Israel." Then Absalom would say to him, "Look, your case is good and right, but there is no deputy of the king to hear you." Moreover, Absalom would say, "Oh, that I were made judge in the land, and everyone who has any suit or cause would come to me, and I would give him justice." And so it was, whenever anyone came near to bow down to him, that he would put out his hand and take him and kiss him.
That was Absalom, the son of King David. He conspired against his father, King David. The young man sat down and planned it very well that he must topple his father, the king, from the throne by killing him. And then he will succeed. He will take the throne. He planned it very well. The passage where we read tells us that he would rise early in the morning and go and stand by the city gate and tell everyone coming to the city, everyone bringing a complaint or a case, that there is no one to take care of your case. Only if I, Absalom, am appointed as judge, I would handle your case. The young man would even go further. When the subjects of the king would want to bow, as it was the system of the past, the young man would stretch forth his hand to say, "Don't bow. You are my brother, you are my sister." And he would kiss him. By that, he succeeded in winning the hearts of all Israel. He planned it very well. He planned it and he won even the heart of Ahithophel, David's advisor, David's counselor. He was now on the side of Absalom while the chief or the king was still alive. This is something not usual. Your own child planning your death so that he can take your house and your car, so that he can take the throne. This is sad. This is to show that even your own flesh and blood can allow the devil to use them to make you go through Gethsemane. And also as a king, even though he had everything he wanted, still he went through Gethsemane through his own son. The conspiracy increased as the young man planned it. It increased to a point where David fled. The king fled just like before when he was persecuted by King Saul. During that time, he was always on the run. Now when everything seemed to be well, his own son put him on the run again because he wanted to kill him. David fled, of course, with some of the men. Some people were on his side, but the rest of the people were on Absalom's side because of how he did to win them. While he was on the run, another man made matters worse. His name was Shimei. He cursed the king and pelted him with stones. Now, if you are in Gethsemane, you would expect people to comfort you. Now, there was Shimei pelting the king with stones, cursing him. As brothers and sisters, when we see our fellow brothers and sisters going through Gethsemane, we should not pelt them with stones. We should not clap our hands and rejoice. We should give them comfort, like what the other group that went with David did. We should not copy what she may did, pelting our fellow brothers and sisters with stones, cursing them. It is not supposed to be so in the house of God. But David, we thank God, he handled the case very well. When
Abishai
wanted to go over and kill that man, he refused. He acted according to the word of God to bless whoever is persecuting you, to pray for whoever is persecuting you. Learn this. King David did not stay in that place forever. He did not stay in Gethsemane forever. He came back some time later and continued to reign in his throne. Same as our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He did not stay in Gethsemane. Where is he? He is ruling. He is reigning. But his kingdom is not of this earth. We cannot see it with our natural eyes. But we know that he is in glory. And he is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. Though he went through Gethsemane, that did not cancel his position as a king. That did not cancel his position as the Lord of Lords. He went through, and he was on the other side, and he continued to reign. And his kingdom is the very same kingdom that we are in today, the kingdom of Jesus Christ, the kingdom of the light.